Thank you very much for giving me this opportunity to come and talk here. I am very impressed by the previous talk, so I will, it's very big shoes to fill. I'm actually a clinician. I see patients here on campus, and essentially, for the past many years, I'm from India. I used to be a clinician there, came here, trained again, and then over the past many years, I've been trying to I do patient-based research and epidemiological research at a much smaller scale. And essentially, I'm going to talk to you about this condition, which is called preeclampsia, which is high blood pressures in pregnancy. I was in Boston for many years working in a lab and studying preeclampsia, and then and I'll show you data about some long story short, I went to Haiti and was very, very surprised by the prevalence of disease in Haiti and how it's actually being treated. So hence the title, try to compare the outcomes of patients who have the same diagnosis but in two very different settings. So I am a maternal fetal medicine specialist, and I was working at Beth Israel Deaconess before I came to University of Chicago. Talk about so maternal mortality, just for all of us, all of the non-clinicians in the audience, is defined as death of a mother, of a woman, which happens while she's pregnant or within 42 days of termination of pregnancy. And I kind of like this slide because it's not just the mom or the baby that dies, but obviously there are so many other things and people around her, such as this little baby that she obviously is about 2 to 3 years old. So some of the key facts about from WHO, there are about 1,000 women who die every day from preventable causes that are related to pregnancy and childbirth. So that's a very large number. In 2013, about 300,000 women died during childbirth or during pregnancy. And we know that 99% of these deaths are actually occurring in developing countries and 50% of them in sub-Saharan Africa. So very, very large burden of maternal death. And this, again, I kind of stole it from the WHO slide from 2014. So why are we talking about this is because hypertensive disorders of pregnancy is the number two cause for maternal death. First is severe bleeding, but in fact, a lot of patients who have high blood pressure then ultimately die from bleeding. So a lot of that bleeding complications that mothers die from are related to high blood pressures in pregnancy. So we're going to talk about this condition called preeclampsia, which is one of the most common medical complications of pregnancy. So in a very true form, it is characterized by hypertension and proteinuria. So sometime in the third trimester, the woman develops high blood pressure and protein. In U.S., the prevalence is about 2 to 3%. And so globally, if you look at maybe the average prevalence is about 5%. It is responsible for about 70,000 maternal deaths per year worldwide. And majority of the deaths occur from seizures and bleeding. So women with preeclampsia can actually have seizures, which is called eclampsia, and they can also have abruption and bleeding. In the U.S., it is the leading cause of prematurity, and I won't go into much of, obviously, the treatment and stuff, but it can often present atypically. And a lot of research, some of the research I'll present is just trying to figure out how you can find these patients. And there is no treatment. And in general, it is also associated with long-term complications, such as cardiac and renal complications. So when I was in the lab, a little molecular biology slide here. So we believe that it's a placental dysfunction. So the primary problem is placental dysfunction, which causes release of certain proteins, which we call biomarkers. So these are the two common biomarkers that we've been working on, for example, soluble FIT and soluble endoglin. And we believe that these biomarkers then cause maternal endothelial dysfunction. So there is widespread endothelial dysfunction for the mother, and then she suffers all these different kind of clinical signs that you see when a woman has preeclampsia. So high blood pressure is protein, it can cause liver dysfunction, cerebral edema, and seizures. So early on, when these proteins were discovered in the lab from Dr. Karamanji's lab in Boston, I was a clinician, I got to the lab, and we were trying to figure out how you can actually use these biomarkers to predict, for example, onset of preeclampsia. And one of the things we did was we said, okay, well, in the third trimester, the woman has signs and symptoms of preeclampsia, how perhaps we can use these biomarkers. So we did a large cohort study, about 1,000 patients, and we looked at patients who were coming to triage. So triage is in kind of a semi-emergency room, who are pregnant in their third trimester, and they have some signs and symptoms of preeclampsia. And what we were able to show that these biomarkers, so the ratio of soluble FIT-PLGF was very high in women who develop preeclampsia within 2 weeks of arrival to triage. And not just the diagnosis of preeclampsia, but these patients who had adverse outcomes had a very high ratio compared to patients who did not have adverse outcomes. So it can actually be used as a discriminatory test to figure out whether you're at risk for adverse outcomes. And then what we did was we kind of compared it. So the problem with preeclampsia and why the burden of the disease is so large is because it's very deceiving. And the things that the clinicians have, such as measurement of blood pressures, measurement of protein, doesn't really correlate with adverse outcomes. It's very hard to kind of figure out who is that patient who is at risk for adverse outcomes. And then it's until it's literally too late. So we compared our ratio of soluble FIT PLGF to other known things that we use, such as systolic blood pressure, measurement of creatinine, uric acid, and by itself, it was actually had a much higher AUC compared to other things. So telling you that perhaps measurement of soluble FIT PLGF is better than the clinical tests that are available. So from this study, and I don't want to bore you too much with science, scientific kind of journey here, but just kind of laying the background, that we were able to show that in our cohort of patients, if they presented early, the ratio was associated with diagnosis of preeclampsia, but more importantly, it identified all patients who were at risk for adverse outcomes. So while I was doing all this research, this was 2008, 2010, I came across this article from Dr. Gordon Smith, who's actually in London, and he wrote this article saying that while all the research is being done in developed countries, women are dying in developing countries. And then he suggested, he also does research on preeclampsia, and he said perhaps what we should do is we should identify women who are at high risk for preeclampsia and somehow transfer them to a higher care facility for early delivery and proper treatment. So there are actually a lot of studies looking at if a woman has a seizure at home, she's at much higher chance to die compared to if she has a seizure in the hospital. So just because you are in a higher level facility, healthcare, by itself, it can improve the outcome. So I proposed a question saying, what is the role of these biomarkers? And we wrote, while we were in Boston, we wrote lots of papers about kind of different clinical scenarios. We asked this question, what is the role of biomarkers in resource-poor countries for prediction of adverse outcomes in women with preeclampsia? When you measure it late in pregnancy, so somehow the patient can actually be transferred and baby can be delivered, and use it as a rule-in test. So when I say rule-in test, it'll be people that if the test is positive, you can say maybe you're at high risk and you need to get treatment. So again, long story short, the reason I went to Haiti was at the time when I was doing research in preeclampsia, I was also interested in cardiovascular disease in women. And seems like Haiti has the world's largest incidence of peripartum cardiomyopathy. So that happens when your heart fails and when you're pregnant. And I wrote this paper, and one physician from New York said, you should go to Haiti and study preeclampsia. He was a medicine person, and he said, there is so much preeclampsia in this hospital, you should definitely go to Haiti and see what's going on there. So I went there. It's a beautiful country. That's my fellow, Melissa, who actually, we just literally bought her ticket and flew down there. That's the front of the hospital. I was standing there. So Haas was the hospital we went. It is in central Haiti. It's about 90 miles up north from Port-au-Prince, so you take a nice drive from there. And it serves a very large population of 300,000 people in a large 610 square mile central Haiti area. So their obstetrical unit has, they do about 900 to 1,000 deliveries per year. They have a 7-bed labor and delivery unit. And when I say labor and delivery unit, that is the labor and delivery unit. So they have a bed. And then there's a patient next in the next bed. They have this fetal monitors, but they don't have paper tracing. So you kind of essentially just listen to the fetal heart rate. There's no actual recording going on. They do have an operating room where they perform C-sections. And that's Dr. Narcisse. He's one of the obstetricians there. So kind of the one of the ways I kind of looked at this from a clinician's scientist point of view is that I wanted to look at the prevalence of the disease. So first of all, define what the disease is. So at that time, when I looked at the world map to figure out what is the prevalence of preeclampsia in different countries, Haiti did not even show up because nobody has actually described the prevalence of preeclampsia. I did find a paper that was published in 2003 from investigators at Yale. So I called them and asked them, are you still studying preeclampsia? And they said, oh no, that was, you know, something we did like a few years ago. So I said, fine, we'll do a first kind of a demographic study looking at what is the prevalence of preeclampsia and what is the prevalence of adverse outcomes in this particular hospital. But more importantly, I was also very interested in figuring out if the angiogenic factors that I've been studying here in US, do they actually correlate with adverse outcomes, especially severe adverse outcomes occurring in Haiti? And then perhaps, which we have not worked on but are currently working on, perhaps developing models of care at a level of a physician, at a level of a hospital, where perhaps you can stratify patients at risk based on the biomarkers. So the first study, like I said, was a retrospective study. We looked at the medical records. With all the caveats of looking at medical records in this hospital, we essentially wanted to evaluate the women who had a diagnosis of preeclampsia, eclampsia, either before or after delivery. So we looked at a two-year record from in 2011 and 2012. So essentially what we found was there were, in that two-year period, there were about 1,700 deliveries. Now, astronomically high rate of preeclampsia, eclampsia, and obviously the prevalence is difficult to define because I don't really know exactly the total number of patients who were pregnant at that time period, but at least in the hospital, out of the 1,700 deliveries that they did, 270 patients had preeclampsia, eclampsia. What was even more surprising, that about 30% of these patients had eclampsia, which is seizures during pregnancy, very, very high rate. And then what was also very interesting to me as a clinician, I've never seen this in US, was a very high rate of postpartum eclampsia. So that's where you deliver and then you seize after delivery, which is kind of a very enigmatic disease just from like scientific point of view. So obviously I had all this data in Haiti and then I had all this data in Boston and I was like, wow, this is like really very different. These patients are not similar to the patients I was seeing in Boston. So I kind of just simply compared the clinical characteristics of patients who came to Haiti compared to patients who were in Boston. And as you can see, women in Haiti were younger, so they were 27 on an average compared to 32. They were, in terms of parity, a little bit more Paris. There was no real difference in gestational age of admission or delivery. And again, you have to understand this is very biased. I did not look at how many women died at home or how many women went to some other hospital. There are no other hospitals, by the way, around this hospital, but perhaps to other dispensaries or something else. What we were amazed by, that the level of hypertension was immense. So in Haiti, the average blood pressure was 160 over 110 compared to Boston, for example, 147 over 92. And then the other thing was obviously very clear, that the number of women who received prenatal care was very low. So in Haiti, only 23% of the women received prenatal care. An average number of prenatal visits was only two, compared to Boston, where 99% of the women received prenatal care with an average number of prenatal visits of 10. And that's pretty average. In the United States, a lot of it's like a pyramid that you, as your pregnancy advances, the number of times that you're going to see your physician actually keeps going up and up. But in terms of adverse outcomes, so we obviously were interested in figuring out what is going on in Haas. So one interesting fact we found was this diagnosis of mild preeclampsia. So mild preeclampsia is an asymptomatic disease. So you don't have any symptoms as a patient, but when you go see the doctor, they will find high blood pressures and protein, and they'll say, oh, you have preeclampsia. So we found that in Boston, about 43% of the women were diagnosed with preeclampsia, while in Haiti, mild preeclampsia did not exist. Nobody asymptomatically is presenting to their doctors who are labeling them with preeclampsia. What was there was very high prevalence of severe preeclampsia, very high prevalence of antepartum eclampsia and postpartum eclampsia. And then also, obviously, unfortunately, there was very high rates of adverse outcomes. So when you look at the fetal outcomes, there were 51 babies who died among 270 patients, but only three babies died out of 170 in Boston. So very, very dramatic, obviously, very, very high rates of IUFD, 20%, so one in five babies are dying. And then the rates of, and unfortunately also, for example, when you look at the maternal death, the rates of abruption were high. Now, I was a little bit surprised why it wasn't very high, like corresponding to this, but because the abruption is a very clinical diagnosis, but also pathological diagnosis. So a lot of times, the placenta obviously don't have a pathology department there, so the placenta is not routinely examined by pathologists. So I think it's a pretty fairly underdiagnosed. But unfortunately, there were five maternal deaths out of those 270 women, but obviously no maternal deaths in Boston. The other interesting thing we kind of did was we looked at the biomarkers. So I'm calling them biomarkers because blood pressure is a biomarker, is predicting something. We found that there was actually no association of blood pressure, systolic or diastolic blood pressure, with any of the adverse outcomes, which, again, people have written about it hundreds of times in multiple different scenarios, and it is a very, very poor biomarker for predicting adverse outcomes. In fact, with blood pressure and protein, the positive predictive value is only about 20%. So clearly, it was very clear that these women were actually very, very sick, and they're dying, and we looked at all different outcomes. It was pretty much crossing one. So hypertension and proteinuria was a poor predictor of association with adverse outcomes. So we went back to answer the second question, whether angiogenic factors are actually associated with adverse outcomes in Haiti. So this was a prospective study that we did there. We went back to Haas. We enrolled patients after their consent. We drew their blood. We kept the blood in minus 20. They did have a lab. And we transported the samples back to Boston and measured the angiogenic factors. So that was the lab there, and that's my fellow Carl. So what we found was, again, kind of expected. I knew it will be. But what we found was that in patients who have early onset preeclampsia, so women who had less than 34 weeks, they have a very, very high levels of angiogenic factor, so very, very abnormal angiogenic profile. And similar results with late onset preeclampsia. And also, interestingly, the early onset preeclampsia, again, it's known, is a very kind of a bad disease. So their levels were higher than late onset preeclampsia. But what was kind of interesting to show and kind of move the field forward was that it was not just the diagnosis of preeclampsia, but the adverse outcomes. So what we did was we characterized adverse outcomes based on kind of some kind of scientific knowledge. So we had severe hypertension as category one, but we kind of looped and bunched in all these adverse outcomes together for category two. And I believe that eclampsia is a separate disease. I really truly believe there's a biomarker out there for eclampsia. So I characterized it separately. And then we felt maternal fetal neonatal death is a bigger outcome than, for example, IUGR. So we kind of grouped them together. What was interesting, then all patients who had preterm adverse outcomes, all of them had very, very abnormal angiogenic profile compared to patients who did not have adverse outcomes. And this was also true for the late onset adverse outcomes. So I think we came back and we kind of concluded that that there is a presence of angiogenic imbalance in the women who have a diagnosis of preeclampsia, but more importantly, there was a profound angiogenic imbalance among all women who had preeclampsia-related adverse outcomes, regardless of gestational age. So when we wrote this paper, there was lots of debate in literature, people saying that, well, you know, sure, it can predict health, but it doesn't predict X, Y, and Z. So I think, and after that, obviously, a lot of people have written a whole bunch of papers about angiogenic factors. So I think I'm just going to conclude with two other slides. So what did we learn from Haiti? So I think, and I didn't show you some, last year we got funded from the Global Health Department here, and we went back and we looked at postpartum hypertension. So again, persistence of blood pressures after delivery. It's very, very prevalent, again, very high blood pressures. So I think we learned that the prevalence of hypertension during pregnancy is very high. And I, again, didn't show you the data, but the treatment is not universal. So even in the hospital where there's availability of antihypertensives, patients are not being treated with blood pressure medication and given, for example, magnesium for prevention of seizures. So what would be the reasonable steps? As a scientist, I ask, perhaps we should explore the existing, and I know there are like, you know, societal burdens and national burdens and poverty burdens. I'm talking about what you can do in terms of being a physician and in this situation. So perhaps we can look at existing hypertension protocols in the hospital if they have them. Looking at the existing knowledge among care providers and dangers of hypertension, do they understand it? And I really truly want to understand what are the barriers for treatment for hypertension. And again, other thing is patient education. Are there any instructions given to patients about dangers of high blood pressures? And then obviously this was my basic question, and I'll show you one more slide as to how I think it needs to work, is in weaker health systems where you don't have so much resources that you can potentially see every patient every week, are there a role of biomarkers that you can predict and actually act on patients who are at high risk? So there was a very recent study that was published in Hypertension Journal in April of 2017 with this very large group. They went to Mozambique in a clinic, and they took patients who were in their third trimester coming to their clinic, and measured their PLGF. And if the PLGF is low, they're at high risk for adverse outcome. They send them to the hospital and say, go get evaluated for preeclampsia. And they were able to show that patients who got delivered had a much, much lower rates of adverse outcomes, including abruption. They didn't really show a big difference in maternal death, but they were able to show some of these very bad adverse outcomes were happening much lower rates in women who had the accessibility to, for example, this biomarker. So I wrote an editorial attached to that paper, and I think this is what is going on. So for the prenatal care, the way we perceive it for the past many, many years, is we have this conventional approach. So what's going on is you repeat measures of blood pressure, you repeat measures of protein, and you evaluate the patients based on non-specific signs and symptoms. So any of the signs and symptoms that we educate our patients, they're very non-specific, can happen when you have migraine or something else going on. It's very resource intense. So you have to do it multiple times. It actually has very low sensitivity and specificity. It's not at all cost effective because you have to have clinics, you have to have all these people. It requires constant access to high quality care. So perhaps come to my clinic and I can pick up preeclampsia faster. You go somewhere else and perhaps they'll miss the disease. And then unfortunately all patients are treated the same way. So everybody goes through this cycle over and over again. It is a model that we practice here in the United States. I see my patients, a lot of them, on a weekly basis. And I think it's a reasonable model if you don't think about cost, but also because majority of the patients are receiving prenatal care. Though a caveat there, I want to point out, I don't have a slide, but United States is the only nation in the developed countries where maternal mortality is actually going up. And a large majority of it is actually delayed diagnosis in preeclampsia and hypertensive disorders. What I think is we need to have something close to a personalized medicine where we can have, and I don't say that the biomarkers that we propose, maybe there are other biomarkers, but have some sort of a biomarker-based risk assessment whereby maybe we'll require less resources. They are very sensitive, so if you kind of look at adverse outcomes, some of the sensitivities are up to 80%. It'll be cost-effective if, you know, the companies actually sell it cheaper. It does have a very high positive and negative predictive value, and I think it'll require less expertise. So if you have a test, and if you say if your number is 85, you're at high risk, and if your number is 2, you're at low risk, so anybody can kind of interpret it. And then essentially you can divide patients into, rather than treating them all the same way, you can stratify them as high risk and low risk. Majority of the patients are actually low risk. They can deliver in their own place wherever the plan was to deliver, but among the patients who are high risk, I think if transferring them to a higher level facility to refer them to physicians with knowledge and perhaps access to high level maternal and neonatal care will actually reduce the maternal and neonatal death rate. So where am I going next? So first of all, before I say that, I want to acknowledge obviously a lot of people, but essentially all the medical staff at Haas, they're fantastic people. My department of OBGYN here gives me all the time and resources to do this kind of work. Dr. Karamanchi has been my mentor for the past 15 years, and then my hospital in Boston at BIDMC and my funding. So where am I going next? I actually was just visiting HUM. We have an MOU, I'm told it's almost signed. So that's Meredith, she's fantastic. She runs the maternity ward there. So we're trying to figure out if we can come up, you know, it's a bigger hospital, more patients to figure this out. So thank you very much.